do you test a new idea, especially one that's expensive or will require a lot of effort? To explore and plan, we can use an analog. Analogs are less expensive, they're easier to create, and they provide a realistic testing environment for our ideas. Have you been thinking about launching a new business? Or maybe you have a project that you'd like to try, but you've never done it before. You may want to consider an analog. So analogs you're probably more familiar with terms that we use, such as flight simulators. You know, if you wanted to be a pilot and fly a high-performance aircraft, you wouldn't just jump behind the controls and take off. Instead, a new pilot will sit in a high-fidelity simulator with an instructor and perhaps even a full crew, learning how the systems of this airplane work, recognizing failures, and then being able to do it themselves. And of course, the agenda, the curriculum has been planned, but they'll have individual learning that they'll take away on areas where they need to improve to succeed. And this is similar in our medical community, where we use medical mannequins to teach our doctors, nurses, maybe if you've even taken a CPR class. And then in science, we use pilot studies before we go and launch a big project. So why do we use analogs? Well, because analogs are more than a model. They're able for us to test our predictions. And because analogs bring together a lot of smart people, they widen our perspectives because all those people are giving their input. And because we go through the actions, we actually do something, then we're able to lead to learning and discovery. So I'd like to tell you about an analog that I participated in with NASA. You know, NASA is planning to go to the surface of a body somewhere in our solar system soon. Whether we go back to the moon, or to an asteroid that's closer to the Earth, or even to the surface of Mars, we'll have done a lot of testing and preparation before we get there. And analogs are one of the ways we do this. So for example, if we want to go to a near-Earth asteroid, we'd want to know how we could actually sample it, so we'd know if there's useful resources, and how did our solar system actually form. And there are thoughts that maybe we could use translation lines, a lot like the ropes we set up here on Earth to rock climb, or maybe jetpacks, or vehicles. And of course, we'll be living closer to these bodies, to the asteroids, and then going to visit them. So the analog I participated in 2012 was called NASA's Extreme Environment Mission Operation, or NEEMO, because it's underwater. And of course, we were looking at how to actually sample an asteroid. So it is more than a model. We went to an actual vehicle that's 62 feet below the ocean surface, 5 miles off the coast of Florida. It's called the Aquarius Habitat. And here, it's about the size of a bus. Here, six of us were crew members, actual astronauts living underwater together in a high-risk environment that's isolated. Starting to sound like a space station? And we had a smaller mission control team back on that coast. And in that control team, of course, we had those flight controllers that do work at Houston. And we had the same people that teach us as astronauts. And we had the engineers that build the tools so that they could see what we were breaking or what we found useful or what we didn't. And we even had flight doctors there to see if the communication delay impacted any of the things that we were doing. Another important person that we had was the safety diver, for the obvious reason of providing the safety, but because they also helped make this less expensive, because they're helping neutrally weigh out any of the equipment that we didn't have time to make neutrally buoyant, as well as they provided that omniscient point of view, because they were around us at all times. So we went out to test these hypotheses about how to actually work at the asteroid. Every day, we'd suit up in our wetsuit and get our helmet on, and we'd go out in the morning and in the afternoon to do our spacewalks. We started out on those translation lines, and it was quickly apparent that this was not the most useful way to sample an asteroid, because we imagine that most asteroids are going to have loose rubble at the surface, and a translation line does not allow you to stabilize yourself well enough unless you're really only scooping loose material. If you want to get something more, it just won't work, and you'll kick up a bunch of sediment, which will be hazardous to you. So then we tried the jetpacks. Jetpacks, right? How cool is that? Except we found out it might not actually be that cool. Remember those safety divers? They were able to point out that in this environment of water, the water was providing drag, and so it was holding us close to the surface we were sampling. But if you were really at an asteroid, you would have to put a pulse into your jetpack for every sample that you wanted to take, and that would quickly waste your propellant and put you in a precarious position. So however cool they were, we realized that maybe jetpacks are only good for a safety measure. Finally, we brought in the vehicles. In this case, they were submersibles. And this led to our big discovery. The vehicle was able to hold us in position. Now we could sample both loose material and firm material and even use bigger tools because it was a lot like working off a robotic arm. And it provided a level of safety because we had that astronaut sitting in the vehicle and able to look out for us. And if we were working with another crew member, they could look out for both of us at the same time. And because of the mass of the vehicle, our inputs on the asteroid would not be wasted propellant. That mass of that vehicle would hold us in place. So now the question becomes, if we go to an asteroid or another body, no matter what, we've still learned. And how many vehicles do you start pulling together to do this learning? And so that's left to another analog. Now let's bring it back to your ideas. Perhaps you're considering opening a new restaurant. What would be the analog? Well, try having four catering parties back to back with the team that you plan to use. And it will help you flush out any of the things that you need to overcome before doing this. Or maybe you're in charge of your family's safety or the safety of your crew member or your coworkers. Well, is your plan really going to work? Have you put it into place or is it just written up in a document? Consider running an authentic drill to see if your 10-year-old is really ready to help you if you're incapacitated or if your coworkers know how to use the AED or other equipment you have. Finally, maybe there's some of you that are in this room that want to go to Mars. Perhaps you want to consider signing up for one of the analogs that NASA takes volunteers for, or go the private route with the Mars Society or things like biospheres. To test new ideas and big projects, especially the ones that are expensive, take a lot of effort, and require a lot of time, we can use an analog, because it leads to discovery and learning. Thank you.